One, my brother, my older brother, who passed away from cancer. He had esophageal cancer, and we thought we had it beat. We really did. I can remember the day that Dan called me and told me he had cancer and told me it was esophageal cancer. And I said, we're going to fight it. That's what we're going to do. And I'm going to be there with you every single step of the way. I'm going to be there. He was on my doorstep because he lived in another country, Quebec, and I lived in Ottawa. And he came to stay with me. And we got him ready, and got him ready for surgery. And it was to decide whether or not they were going to actually do anything for him. Part of the team said no. The head of the team said yes. He had radiation and chemotherapy every day for a month. They gave him a month to rest, and then they were going in to do major, major surgery. He had a 50-50 chance of survival on the table, and we were gonna do it. And I had an angel, pewter angel that I bought, and when you turned it around, it said, "I'm with you every step of the way," and I kept saying that. That was my mantra to him, every step of the way. Unfortunately, I took a train down because I couldn't drive when he was having surgery. And I took a train down with my birth mom, and I took my luggage into Notre Dame in Montreal Hospital, and with me, and I had to pee so bad I went into the bathroom, and as fate would have it, my sister-in-law ran into the bathroom and was crying, like screaming crying. As I came out of the stall and I saw her, and I had to shake her because I thought my brother died on the table, and she told me in French that no, there was nothing they could do for him, and I didn't understand. And she told me there was a cancer underneath in his pleural cavity and had spread. And this cancer was only two, it was a separate cancer. It wasn't, it didn't metastasize into any other place. It was a separate cancer. And it was a cancer that only 2 to 5% of the population get. And unfortunately, my brother got it. It had spread in that month of waiting for surgery like wildfire. It had spread to his kidneys, his lungs, his liver, everywhere. And then when they saw this, when they opened him up, they closed him back up. There was nothing that could be done. When he came out and they put him in intensive care, I don't lie. My face is an open book. You see this face? It doesn't lie. My father always said, "Kitten, don't try to lie. Your face is an open book. It can be read." My brother knows that. My brother knew that. I thought, "Dear God, what do I do?" I know his doctors were going to see him the next morning at 5 in the morning to explain to him, to tell him there was nothing they could do for him. I didn't know what to do. I had to go back and sit there and be with him. He was throwing up. I was wiping his nose, wiping his vomit, rubbing his back, everything. And then he sat back and looked at me and said, why don't I have all these tubes and everything on me? And I said, I can't remember what I said now. I said something. And he said, "Are you sure?" I said, "Yeah." "Really?" "Yeah. Yeah." Even then, I look convincing, right? Yeah, horse's ass. I said, well, yeah, listen, it could be something good. Look at my face when I say that. Listen, it could be something really good. Convincing face. Yeah, right. I said, your doctor's coming at 5 o'clock tomorrow morning. So, you know, let's wait. Let's see what happens. Long story short, the doctor came in and started talking to him, and I grabbed his hand. He knew what was coming wasn't good as soon as I grabbed his hand. He said in French, I'm sorry, Daniel. There's nothing we can do for you. We found this type of cancer, and there's nothing we can do. And then he said, well, we have options. My brother was like, options? What options? We have options? My brother wanted to live so bad and fought so hard. For 8 months, he fought. He had this mammoth tumor in his esophagus, encroaching on it in his stomach, and couldn't really swallow or eat anything or stuff like that. And he had tubes coming out of him and everything. And he said, oh, we have palliative care, you know, and they can do things. And I don't know whether my brother was, you know, I just didn't quite understand. But I went to talk to the doctor afterwards, and I said to him, why didn't you find this? Why didn't you tell me? Why didn't you see this? I was angry. I was so angry. And he said, I'm sorry. We did not see it a month ago. How could you not see that? How could you not see that on scans? How could you not see that? He said, it's an aggressive form of cancer that only 2 to 5% of the population have. And I'm so very sorry to say your brother has it. It's separate from the cancer he has. And it's not a metastasis. It's separate. Your brother was hit with 2 different cancers. I asked how long he had. He said, 6 to 8 months. But right now, our thing is to get him up and out of this hospital and to, here's that quality of life thing, to get him as much quality of life as he can. Half. My brother left that hospital, and we were trying to boost him up with as much boost as possible. And I'm not talking about the drink. To say, you know, what can you say? But he fought. We didn't talk about it. A week later, he was sent by hospital, by ambulance, from Chateau Gay, where he lived, to Montreal, where they siphoned off a huge amount of fluid in his stomach. Massive amount. Like liters. A fluid. They sent him to Anna Leberge, where he lived in Chateau Gay, and they got him a room in palliative care. It's a massive room. I think it was bigger than my living room, with windows that looked out. It was a beautiful room, and he had everything there. We made sure he had everything there. It was a TV, everything he wanted, it was there. I thought he had 6 to 8 months. I wanted to take him to a cottage. I wanted to take him. It's at the tip of the fleuve Saint Laurent and Gaspésie. And I wanted to take him to a cottage. So, because he loved the cottage. He loved my dad's cottage. Just so he could be there for maybe a week with all his stuff We go trucking with all his stuff. I wanted to do that for him. So at least he had some kind of happy memory left. He never gave up. He never gave in. That's for darn sure he never did. He was a fighter. Oops, sorry. Even after all this time, he was a fighter. He fought. He fought so hard. He was so brave. He's my big brother. He had his moments where he didn't want anybody around and said, I'm going to die alone. I said, oh, the hell you are. The hell you are. I'm gonna be right there, so F you. The hell you are. I bought him the tutus. And I said, when I'm not here, these tutus are, that's you and that's me. And I'm watching you when I'm not here, and I'm in Ottawa. I'm watching you. I called him at least 2 or 3 times a day and speak with him. Things progressed rather rapidly. Things progressed rather rapidly. I was down quite a bit to see him. And when he was in Notre Dame Hospital, I was there. My sons came with me as well. My birth mom came too when he was in palliative care in Anna Laberge. I was there as well. And I talked to him all the time. All the time. We'd never discussed anything. Nothing. I don't think he wanted to. And I wasn't about to bring it up. When things were getting close, July, I rented a big Escalade. My dad and my mom were both ill. My mom has end stage now Alzheimer's, and my father, who has since passed in 2014, had dementia and a whole bunch of other issues. So I got an Escalade because they needed special care. And we all drove, I drove down to Châteauguay and to Anna Laberge, to his room in palliative care. I knew it was the last time my parents would see their son alive. I let my parents stay and talk to my brother. It's hard when you have Alzheimer's and dementia on board and them not understanding that their son is dying. We already lost my sister. Now we're going to lose my brother. So they were tired and wanted to go home after a little while. I kissed my brother. I said, I'll be back. He says, I know you will. We had to put on gowns and we had to put on all of that stuff when we entered his room. Towards the end, it didn't matter. I drove my parents back to Ottawa, into their home, their residence that they were staying, that looked after them. Brought the Escalade back. A few weeks after that, I got a call at work that I needed to come quickly. I had already been speaking with him on that Friday. Saturday went, Sunday went, Monday went, and I got a call on Tuesday saying, you need to come down here quickly. Because I told him, please don't give me drop on a dime notice because it takes a few hours to get down there. My son drove me, my older son, and we drove. We got there around 5:30 at night, and I stayed with him. I was asked to stay with him, and I said, not a problem. I was awake all day, all night with him. He didn't say much, and he was so frail. What cancer does to you is horrible. It really does. He was hurt, somewhere in his back hurt. So I lifted him up literally with one hand, and I threw the bed thing that they put under you. I chucked it across the room because I figured that was hurting him. And then he was so tired. So I brought, he didn't want to sleep. He never wanted to sleep. So I rolled over the table and I put a pillow on it. And I said, put your head down on it. And he did for a little while, but he didn't sleep. I didn't sleep. I watched him the whole entire night in the morning. 8 o'clock in the morning, he said to call his wife. I did. I knew why. And she said, I said, get here now. And she said, what do you mean? Why? I said, get here now. And she said, she started to cry. And I said, get here now. Don't cry, please. Get here now. Bring everybody. She said, is it that bad? I said, get here now, please. They made it to the hospital. They saw him and she lost it. It wasn't how she saw him before. It wasn't like that. He had changed drastically. And she cried and cried and tried to get him to sit back, and he wouldn't. I said, no, please, please don't push him back. There's something. I don't know what's wrong, but he can't sit back. The doctors came in immediately and kneeled down beside him. And apparently they had talked about an induced coma. My brother said, when the time comes, that he would let them know. He was in such pain. He didn't never took anything, and he was in such pain. And I said, stop being brave. Would you please stop being brave? There is nothing to be brave about now. Stop it. Please. You're suffering so bad. I don't want to see you suffer anymore. I looked at his wife and I said, please, please. There's something you can do for me right now is convince him to do this. He looked at me and he said a few words when the doctors were there and said, and turned to me and said, my sister was with me all night. I love my sister. She stayed with me all night. And she helped me all night. And I love my sister. It's the last words he spoke. Cancer is not discerning. It doesn't matter who you are, whether you're young or you're old, it doesn't matter. What it does to you is horrible. What it does to you is horrible. What it does to the people you love is horrible, and you're watching it. What it does to them and how they feel it is horrible. It's nothing nice to say about it. And you get to the point, you just want it to stop for them. You just want it to stop. You just want it to end. You just don't want them to suffer anymore. So he agreed. He agreed. And I went and got the priest at the hospital quickly. And we did last rites. And he participated. And after that, it was quick. Very quick. They had protocols they had to observe, and they had a book, and they opened it, and there was about five people in the room with nurses and doctors. And they administered, they kept going protocol one, protocol two, protocol three, and they kept going on and on and on. They gave us time to say what we wanted to say, because once they did this, we wouldn't wake up anymore. That would be it. So we did. We took our turns saying what we said to them. And then that was it. That was it. He hung out for a while longer. When it he was administered, whatever this was, his breathing, you could tell his breathing was funny. They thought he was going to go then, but he didn't. He still hung on. And at 3:26 p.m. on a Wednesday, he passed on April 22nd, his son's birthday, his older son's birthday. Everybody was sleeping, and I earlier had gone out to get a coffee, which I don't get. I was tired, and I sat down, and I was just trying to roll this all in my head. And then I went back to the palliative care unit and his room, and everybody was sleeping, so I didn't want to wake anybody up. I put my bum against this windowsill with all of the massive windows, and I looked at him, and I immediately noticed his breathing was funny. And what I say by funny is his chest would go up and then down, and then it would do funny stuff. I knew it was like, I just knew something was happening then and there. I knew it. And his breaths were becoming longer apart. As I moved closer to the bed, I put one knee on the bed and one arm around him. And my other arm, I rubbed his forehead. And I gently said to him, "Go. You can go now. Go. Go meet Susan. Meet Sue, please. She's waiting for you. Go meet Sue. Sue is our sister." As soon as I said for him to go, that it was okay, he stopped breathing. He took his last breath, and that was it. Before, when he was administered this, while they were out, I stayed behind with the nurses and I washed him. I washed his feet. When they did the log roll, they noticed the cancer had eaten through his back. That's why he couldn't lie down. And that's why he was hurting. He was in that kind of pain. He was a fighter. He was a champion. And he was awesome. And he was my brother, Daniel. And he fought. And he was funny. And he was kooky. And he was crazy. And he was a lot like Matt Thomas. Sorry, Matt, I call you kooky and crazy. My brother was a lot like him. Really, I saw Matt Thomas and the things he was doing, and I immediately saw my brother. I was like, oh my Lord, that's my brother. So I don't know. I connected a lot with the Thomases for a number of reasons, not only cancer. I had cancer twice, but now I have incurable diseases that are life-threatening, that I fight every day, and I'm never going to give in, and I'm never going to give up. I could. And I could go be up with everybody. But life is too precious. And I have a lot down here, my boys, my grandkids. until the day he closes my eyes. I will continue on, even though the doctors don't know how I'm here. I will still continue. I am the anomaly. The anomaly will continue until that day. So, there you have it. That's the story of my brother Daniel. And how proud I am of him. He was always a jackass asshat. But he was a funny jackass asshat. I loved him very much. He was my older brother. And my sister was my older sister. And I was a baby. So, having nobody to guide me, trying to find my way, and having one family be hit with so much is just amazing. Every time I think about it. My father is gone. He passed in 2014 from a massive, massive stroke. I had to be the one to pull all the things off of him. I had to make that call. The love of my life, my father. The wind beneath my wings, my father. I started to be diagnosed with things after my brother. 3 days after I put my brother in the ground. And then in 2015, things just went cuckoo for me and my health. My mother now has end-stage Alzheimer's and she's in a home and doesn't really recognize a lot. So effectively, besides me and my sons, my family's wiped out. And I know I'm laughing about that, but no, it took me a long time to come to terms with that. Because we used to have massive dinners and Thanksgiving and Christmas and all of that. And now I sit alone with Mr. P. And that's tough. But I've learned to deal with it. Anyways. Peace. Love you. Ta-ta. Bye-bye. Be good to each other. Be good. So, this is Daniel, and I do believe Sam Smith is singing this with me, too. My brother was a kooky guy, and I'm singing this for him. I'm also singing it for a very inspirational Daniel, who I had, Daniel Pee-wee Toms Thomas, who I had the good fortune. And I was blessed, and it was good faith, that I crossed paths. We crossed paths on YouTube a long time ago. And I believe that was meant to happen. And I was meant to see every single thing that he put out, and I did. And he was and will continue to be such an inspiration to me in my life. So here's Daniel. Daniel is traveling tonight on a plane. I can see the red tail lights headed for Spain. Oh, and I could see Daniel waving goodbye.
Oh, it looks like Daniel. Must be the clouds in my eyes. They say Spain is pretty, though I've never been. But Daniel says it's the best place he's ever seen. Oh, and he should know he's been there enough. God, and I miss Daniel. Oh, I miss him so much. Oh, Daniel, my brother, you are older than me. Do you still feel the pain from the scars that won't heal? Your eyes have died, but you see more than I. Daniel, you're a star in the face of the sky. Daniel, my brother, you were older than me. Do you still feel the pain from the scars that won't heal? Your eyes have died, but you see more than I. Daniel, you're a star in the face of the sky. Daniel is traveling tonight on a plane. I can see the red tail lights headed for Spain. Oh, and I can see Daniel waving goodbye. Kinda looks like Daniel. Must be the clouds in my eyes. Oh God, it looks like Daniel. Must be the clouds in my eyes. Mm. Ooh, doo, doo.